that's as high as it should go, and then it goes back down. Yeah, this is a way to, this is a strategy for them. Yeah.
Are there any photographs of Reger playing or conducting his own music?
Yes.
And if so, what do they tell? More along those lines.
There are four photos of him at organs.
Mm-hmm.
Two of them are at the Leipzig Conservatory. One of them is at the Velta Organ Factory in Freiburg, where he made his organ rolls. He was in the process of making organs. And then there's another photo of him at the organ at the Kaiser Wilhelm Church in Berlin. And all of those photos are posed.
Okay.
In other words, you can tell he's just sitting there, posed. So it's not like he's in the act of playing. So actually not very much. I don't believe there's actually very much that can be told. There are many, many pictures of him at the piano. Many photos, drawings of him at the piano. I don't know that there's anything to be read out of it. And also, in terms of his conducting, that's an interesting thing because the outsider in him. He was very much against what the Germans call the Pultvirtuosen, the virtuosos of the music stand. So these people, because you have to realize that the vocation or the profession of the virtuoso star conductor was a thing that was on the rise at the time of Reger's youth and really peaked in the years of Bülow. And in the years of Nikisch. These are the, you know, when you think of the Pultvirtuose, when the Germans think of that, they think of Arthur Nikisch. And he was very much, he was militantly against this idea. So he trained the Meiningen Orchestra, which is an orchestra that's about half or more, again, the size of the large orchestras of the time, Berlin and Vienna, were at least twice the size of the Meiningen. And so this was like a chamber orchestra to him. And he trained these people in rehearsals in a system of dynamics that went from four pianos to four fortes. And he trained them with pedantic markings on the page so that he could, and this was sort of a gimmick. It was a gimmick and he used it often. It was said again and again in the incidental music to Rosamunde of Schubert. He did that over and over again with them. And he would begin the orchestra, and he would lay down his baton, and he would walk off the stage, and they would play it. And this was a huge sensation, because he was abdicating, he was showing that what I do is actually just an illusion, because if you prepare these people in rehearsal, they can just do it, they follow each other, you know? So it was a huge rhetorical statement against this idea of that. You know, not into it at all. That's interesting. I would say this particularly to organists, because organists have this instrument. I have a friend, Bernhard Haas, who's a big deal Reger player in Germany, and I heard him give a master class a few years ago. And this guy comes out and he's playing something. I think it was, you know, the big introduction of Pasacalli in D minor. And he comes out and he starts and he draws the entire organ and he starts to play. And this is just painfully loud. And Bernard stopped him and he said, I have a question for you. He said, whose forte do you think is louder? The forte of Beethoven or the forte of Reger? Of course, the answer is the forte of Beethoven is louder. Because the dynamic range between what is the softest acceptable sound, musical sound, and the loudest acceptable musical sound is essentially the same for these two people. It's just that in the notation, What Reger does is divide the spectrum into smaller units. So when Reger writes forte, he doesn't mean the same thing that Beethoven. I mean, when Beethoven writes forte, he means the next thing down from everything. Because double forte is it, right? For Reger, double forte is just on the, it's on the way, right? It's on the way. And that doesn't mean that what the triple and quadruple forte, organo pleno at the end, does not mean oppressive sound. It doesn't mean this. I have read now every review ever written about a concert of Carl Strauber. I think I've read them all. I'm writing his biography. And so there's so many descriptions of his playing. And there's so many descriptions of Reger's playing and his conducting of the orchestra and, you know, pianists and so on and so forth. There are occasional complaints about Strauber and his playing, about playing this kind of what the Germans call Säuseln. It's so soft that you can barely hear it. And there's some complaints about that. There is not in any of that stuff, not one remark that anything that any of these people did was too loud. Just doesn't come up. And if you go and you play the Zauer organ in St. Thomas in Leipzig, his organ there, which has been beautifully restored now, and you play the organo pleno there and you stand down in the church, it's not loud. It's grand. it fills the room, but it is not something that makes you want to go. Not at all. It's just not possible. It's not even possible. So you might keep that in mind with, you know, modern organs, which are more inclined, you know, be right there in your face. This is not what he intends. That's definitely not what he intends. You know, it might be what Ligeti intends. Maybe, but it's not what Reger. I know that for a fact. That's not what Reger intends. Yeah.
Was Reger much of an improviser at the organ?
Yes.
And how so?
Yeah, there are a lot of descriptions of him improvising both at the piano and the organ. He's said to have been able to improvise fugues, double fugues, preludes. In fact, there was a series of concerts in, he liked to play the organ in the cathedral at Kolberg, which is now in Poland. I can't remember the name of that town now in Poland, but at the time it was part of Germany, called Kolberg, on the east, on the Ostsee over there. And he would vacation there, and when he vacationed there, he'd like to play the organ in recitals. And there are very exacting descriptions of his improvisations there. Pasacaglias, things like this. And when you hear the descriptions, they sound very much like descriptions of the written down music. So I think he probably was able to conceive things in his head and do that better. Also, as a continuo player, he's a very good player. You know, the Bach Brandenburg Five, and then he played the continuo along with the full score. He didn't have his own score; he just played it on the orchestra, not the orchestra score. Yeah. Good. Thank you. It's like Wagner. If you get too far in it, it'll suck you in. It just, and then you won't ever get out of it again. Quicksand.